نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الله الذي خلقكم من ضعف ثم جعل من بعد ضعف قوة ثم جعل من بعد قوة ضعف وشيبة يخلق ما يشاء وهو عليم القدير. صدق الله العظيم. It is always a pleasure to address you in this masjid. When I came to UK 2003, because the first masjid that accommodated me, I come for a very short visit, and the moment I came, I received an email from one of my friends and said, "Molana, where's your next bayan?" That was not in my plan, and Molana and the member of the committee always welcome me, so if I opted to give a small bayan, I won't intend to be long. I know you are tired. The topic I intend discussing in front of you today is a topic that is of concern not only to you and me, but the entire EU community, the European Union. As you know, last week there was one of the biggest strikes in France regarding jobs. About 26 years old, the employer can fire you without any reason. And in UK as well, there was a big strike in London recently regarding the people about their retirement pension scheme. All this brouhaha, all these problems are not simple things for us as Muslims to overlook. These are extremely serious issues that we have in this situation as from 2011, and worse will be in 2040 according to prediction, according to the actuarial scientists and statisticians. But we as Muslims, there are four sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to draw your attention. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that He is Al-Fa'al. Allah does whatever He wishes. Nobody can change that. That's our aqidah. Allah is Al-Khaliq and Rabb, Al-Razaq. Allah is the one who provides food. We cannot deny that as Muslims. You become kafir if you deny that. Allah is Al-Muhyi. He is the one who gives life. And Allah is Al-Mumit. Allah is the one who takes life also. These are the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody can change that. But because we're living in a world of asbab, a world of means, and we cannot talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us aql to use, our intellect. For this reason, Ibn Qayyim Jawzi rahimahullah says, the greatest folly that man can do is not to use his intellect. And this is why insan is above ashraful makhluqat. Why I have raised these issues is, when we face any problem, this problem is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And insan is supposed to use two things to face this test. The very first thing is his iman, and the second thing is his aql, his intellect. Now, this problem that we're having in UK, I don't want to deal with the EU because the topic will go hours and hours. We're having a big aging population. All this problem that you see around us, the government is taking certain decisions, drastic decisions, to change your age to extend from 65 maybe to 70 years, or to change the pension scheme. These are not something that the government wants to do. There are serious problems that have cropped up over the last 30 years. And this is the fruit we are bearing in UK, in Italy, especially in Italy. Big problem where the government is paying people to have kids. Because the aging which started in the 1940s of the Second World War, now this population is aging. We have not created, we haven't have enough children to grow, to fill in the gap. And this is having great repercussion on everybody here. Your tax you're going to pay, your age you're going to go for retirement, your pension you're going to receive, And many other economic ripple effects is going to have, which I'm going to discuss few of them. For this reason, it is of great concern for us as Muslims when we are faced with an aging population. In UK, you've got to expect changes, drastic changes in the legislation. If we are not going to be affected by that, our children definitely will be affected by those legislation. And we as Muslims, what are our responsibility as British? What are our responsibility as Ummah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who are dwelling here as minorities? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put our roots in this country. This is why we have come here. Because the grass was greener compared to India, Pakistan or Bangladesh or whatever. This is why we came here. But we came here, we can change our intention. This hijra that we made, or our fathers made, or our dada made, convert this into an ibadah. Because based on our niyat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can change halat. This problem that has cropped up, there are two main reasons behind it. If you look in the history after the Second World War, there is a beautiful book written by Maulana Maududi Sahab. Of course, there are certain written kalam on him, but what is good you take. His book, Birth Control. And another book he wrote, Paradigm Status of Woman in Islam, where he has drawn a picture regarding the population boom, what happened after First World War and Second World War in Europe, where 30 million people were killed. There was a need to reconstruct Europe. I don't want to go into detail what happened in Germany, etc. Only in Germany, there was more than 30,000 bombs released on Germany. Just to give you an idea what transpired. 30 million people died. These are not ordinary things that happened. The woman started revolting for polygyny, to have more than, to allow to change the law, to have one man can have more than one wife. But the church objected to that. There were big problems of the First and Second World War in Europe. Then the law started changing, birth control started. Because there was a need for women to substitute men at work. I don't want to go into labor legislation, but there was big changes that took place in UK. And when women started working, this changed the physiognomy of the family structure. This encouraged promiscuity at work and encouraged the development of the pill for birth control. And therefore, this was easy now for illicit sexual intercourse. And this is one of the reasons that we see birth control was one of the fruits that Europe has to bear to allow women to go and work, number one, without any control. I'm not against women working, but there are regulations in Sharia. Number two, to go for the pill. There was a need for economic development. People started working and they started controlling the number of children they're going to have. If you look at the statistics, in the 1971, the average British woman were giving plus minus 2.71 children. That's the average. Recently in UK, it's 0.74. Almost 50% it went down. This is a mindset which has been created, and therefore one of the main problems that I've read many documents from the FSA, from the House of Lords, etc., from the OECD also I've read documents. One of the main reasons for the aging population in Europe is that very issue that women do not want to have children. Infertility has dropped. Infertility doesn't mean they cannot have children. No. They do not want to have children. The second problem is there have been some improvement in health and the age, the life expectancy increased from 42, 43 years old in the 1950s. Now it is approximately 75 for men and 80 for women in UK. So the mortality rate also decreased. These are the two main reasons. But we as Muslims, these are sabab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala plans fail, but we do not know what are the plans. Therefore, we have to take decisions. If you look at the statistics about this aging population, and bear with me what I'm telling you, brothers. If it is not affecting you now, it's going to affect your children in the next 10 years. There will be drastic changes in legislation on your pension scheme, on your hours of work. Maybe there will be forced upon you to work as well. Like it happened after the Second World War in Germany, where every German had to give one day free to the state to build up Germany. We are moving in this direction. Not now. In 10 years, 20 years' time, this is what is coming. Right now in UK, one out of six persons is above 65 years. That is pension age, retirement. By the year 2011, it will be one out of five. It is expected by 2040, one out of four. That is your support ratio. The amount of people that need to work to support an old person is decreasing. What is our responsibility as Muslims in this situation? This is not an ordinary thing. I'm going to bring ayat of Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to make us think, what is the scenario that is happening around us? What is happening in London? What is happening in Birmingham? We got to think about it. What is happening in Leicester? What are the statistics of the Muslim of Leicester? What are the statistics and the doings of the Muslim in London? You get approximately 2 million Muslims. Some say 1.8, some have gone to 3. A conservative figure, we say 2 million. Out of 2 million Muslims, 1 million are residing in London, brother. 150,000 in Birmingham. The rest are spread between Leicester and the North. Think our demographic distribution. Where are we going? How are we organizing ourselves? How are we structuring ourselves? These are food for thought. Hazrat Umar al-Farooq radiallahu ta'ala, if you ponder on his khilafah, you will understand how socially, financially, he was structuring the society. Example, the city of Kufa was built by him. He created a city. And from that city, he transferred 1,500 Sahaba Kiram to Kufa to rebuild the civilization of Islam in Iraq. They are food for thought. The Sahaba did not go there because the grass was greener. Yes, the grass was greener in Kufa because Arabian Peninsula was an arid land. Kufa, Iraq, was green land. And now the most refined oil also is in Iraq. They did not go there. They could have done it. When Hazrat Umar al-Farooq radiallahu ta'ala won over Iraq, brothers, he did not, he changed the law. He did not distribute the land among the Mujahid. Bilal radiallahu ta'ala and the other Sahaba ikram, how can you change the law? In the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these were being distributed. There's a sort of rebelling against the Khalifa. Umar radiallahu ta'ala refused to accept the argument. He said, if you Quraysh, if you the Sahaba of Rasulullah, you're going to go back in agriculture, who will progress his deen of Islam? He changed the law. These are vision of Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Are you going to tell me Umar radiallahu ta'ala change the Quran? No, you got to understand the spirit of the Quran. In the same way, in the time of Umar radiallahu ta'ala, there was a great famine, there was no food to eat. People started receiving food. Umar radiallahu ta'ala did not cut the hand of the people. Are you going to tell me that Umar radiallahu ta'ala did not know the ayah of the Quran that said when a person sees, he must cut his hand? No, he knew it. But the spirit of the Quran, the spirit of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of his law, you got to understand that. And this is we are lacking in our thinking. We are not thinking progressively like the Sahaba Kiram were thinking. I give you another example. Hazrat Umar bin Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu, who was known as Umar Thani, he was the sixth or seventh Khalifa among the Banu Amawiyah. In his time, the Banu Amawiyah were making jihad one way to conquer the whole territory. There was about half of the world they were conquering already. He stopped the jihad. The people say, why are you stopping jihad? You say, the Prophet was not sent as a tax collector. The Prophet was not sent as a tax collector. He stopped that because the Zimmi was giving money to the Baitul Mal. And the Baitul Mal, they were afraid, we lose the money. He said, no, the Rasulullah was not sent as a tax collector. He was Rahmatulil Alameen. When he stopped that, he changed the whole fighting policy of the Muslim Empire. Those people saw the beauty of Islam. They embraced Islam. Instead of giving one dinar, maybe they were giving 10 dinars because why? Now they have to give zakat. They got more money in the Baitul Mal. It is reported the time of Umar bin Abdul Aziz when he sent the collector of zakat to Egypt. The man collected zakat. The economy was so flourishing, they could not find a single person who was a recipient of zakat. He wrote back to Hazrat Umar bin Abdul Aziz, who was in Damascus in those days, and said, "What am I supposed to do?" He said, "Please pay me those money." This is a vision, the political, financial, social vision that Islam demands us to do. In this situation that we are facing in Europe, in UK right now, with an aging population, that will have an effect. Maybe you tell me what you're talking, it's 10 years time, tahe to tahe. Why? This is not the Islamic way of thinking. We have to plan. Allah has given an aqal. We got to use our intellect for the next generation. This also in the eyes of the Quran, I can prove you, where we make dua, oh Allah, have mercy on those who went before us. We as Muslims, our ta'alluq is not cut. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the hadith, reported by Imam Nawawi rahimahullah, that all my sahaba, the people, my brothers, sahaba ikram, radiallahu ta'ala, say, "Who are your brothers?" They thought it was them. Say, "No, you are my ashab. My brothers are those who will come after me, and they will love me without seeing me." This link with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have to understand that. We got to stand as the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is not an ordinary issue we're discussing here, the aging population in Europe and in UK. If you look at the statistics, I'm just going to give you a few statistics from the statistics office. You will realize that the population of UK now shifted from 55 million to nearly 60 million. Right now, it's 60 million. Out of the 60 million, about 2 million are Muslim. Right? Compared to 1971, where it was 34 million. Which means, the present statistics, one in every five people are under 16, which means they are not fit to work on the market. And one in six people is above 65, which means they are not fit to work on the market. What is happening right now is there are more aging people. The more aging people, people are becoming old. They're getting 65, they can live to 70, they can be 75 to 80. More people are falling in this bracket than the youth putting on the market to substitute this withdrawal from the market. What would be the responsibility we are supposed to carry? What are we supposed to do to substitute that market? 16% of the population of UK are already above 65, and this will hit approximately 30% in the next 20 years. 30% of your population will be dependent, excluding your children. 30% of your population will be old. What are we supposed to do with all those people? That's the question. How are we supposed to contribute towards this drastic situation that will prevail? You can tell me, okay, there are migrants coming from India, Bangladesh. This has been discussed already by the House of Lords. This is not a solution to the problem. Because migration brings in its own problem, its own social problem, its own personality problem, its own clash with cultural clash, its own legislation, its own tax purpose. There are so many problems with migration. Migration has not been a solution. It's part of the solution. And migration in UK right now is 100,000 people coming every year. According to the UN, they expected 500,000 qualified workers. They are not getting 500 qualified workers to take over the aging population in UK. It is a Herculean task for the government to achieve that to sustain the economy. It's not something easy that we're going to look over and say, "No, no, that's not a problem." Just like the drug problem, you say, "No, it's a smoke. Today, everybody knows what is happening about drugs. Just go to high schools now, you see what our Muslims are doing. Just go. You will see right now, you will see. We don't have to talk about it. We're making this a taboo. But this is reality. Mixed marriage in our community. We don't want to talk about mixed marriage. How many girls of ours are married with non-Muslims, which is haram? In the same way, there are so many things we are afraid to talk in the masajid. But these are reality at the grassroots level. We got to address it. We got to use our intellect. Find solutions. That Sahaba Kiram found solutions. What are the implications of this issue that I'm raising in front of you brothers? That UK is having an aging population. The first problem is the impact on the food industry. Have you thought about it? What impact it will have on the food industry? I'll just give you an example, which I got from a fact sheet. It says that only 45% of current pensioners have made additional financial arrangements in their for their retirement. Only 45% has considered, what am I going to do? Then they say, according to government figures, more than half of the nation's single pensioners have net incomes of less than £90 a week. Islam tells us to sit like this and do not remove poverty? No. The average old person is getting less than £90 a week. How is he going to survive? We as Muslims, what is our responsibility? Well, it's going to be our turn. If we are not going to do it now, it's going to be our turn. In 10, 20 years' time, 30 years' time, it will be our turn. The food industry, you've got to realize that the demand of the old people is completely different from the demand of the young people. You won't expect a person who hasn't got teeth to eat crisps. Difficult for him. The milk that he drink will be different. He got his own disease, that he got his diabetes, he got cancer, he got heart problem. This will affect the food industry in UK. This is one aspect. When 30% of your population will be above 65 years old, this will be a big change in your food industry. The second problem you can have is in your health industry. The government is really worried about your health industry. If you say by 2031, they predict that the number of cases of coronary disease will increase by 44%. 44% by 2031 in coronary disease. And there are doctors here, they will tell you what the seriousness of this matter here. How much it's costing the state to sustain old people. Then, it continues that heart failure will increase by 54%. And the number of cases of atrial fibrillation will increase by 46%. The three dominating diseases in UK is cancer, heart problem and diabetes. Just to give you an idea on those three diseases alone, India and Russia alone last year spent about $1.7 trillion. These are not ordinary figures I'm putting in front of you. $1.7 trillion. Only two countries in the world spent to attend to these three diseases only. These are serious figures I'm putting in front of you. So the impact of an aging population on the economy, and of course we are part of this economy, it will affect the Muslim as well. According to a research done by Dr. Professor Aziz Sheikh, the population that is more dependent on the NHS are the Muslims, mainly from the Bangladeshi population. These are our brothers and sisters. Are we going to sit like this? We go further. If you look in the housing department, because the aging population, I'm summarizing it, the government has to build in the next 10 years or maybe 5 years approximately 3 million houses. Because the old people have their own demand, those houses will be depreciated. And our fathers are staying with us. And we get married, we want to leave them and go away. Because why? But who doesn't want to stay with mother-in-law? We don't know, the concept of Sabbath has gone out of our life. The concept of respecting elders have gone out of our life. We're going to hack now, suddenly we want the woman's rights. We are not having a holistic view of what is happening. Yes, according to fiqh, that is her right. I'm not denying that. But, if you read Hayat al-Sahaba, volume 3, a person wanted to give divorce. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala intervened, said no. To give divorce to your wife, you can give. But look at the holistic picture, the bigger picture. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala intervened and said no, don't give divorce. This is what we call hikmah in Sharia. One is fiqh, and one is hikmah. At times, you got to go for hikmah. Our youth have lost this concept of respecting our father and mother, mother-in-law and father-in-law. This is, in as far as the housing department is concerned, it's a big, huge issue. huge, very, very huge problem, especially in London and southeast of England. It's a huge problem, housing problem for the aging people. Another issue, I'm going to come to the Islamic part as well, is the pension problem. You have seen it last week. I don't have to tell you about the pension issue. There's one whole document from the FSA, the highest authority in the country, regarding restructuring the entire pension issue. People are not happy, but this is what the trend will be. I think the report on Italy also, they're going to change the pension law. I think the law from South Africa also, they're changing the law. In Germany also, they're changing the law of pension, which means if it is now, it is £90, in 20 years' time, when you're going to retire, maybe you're going to get £50 only. You're going to sit like this and do nothing? You have to do something for your future, brother. All of us know this hadith, famous hadith. Tie your camel and say tawakkal ala Allah. We all know this hadith, but we don't want to make any progress in our thinking. What are we supposed to do in the future? This is a whole document from the FSA. I haven't got time to go into details with that. Another repercussion that you're going to find, very, very important, is with the redesigning of the job. The government is going to redesign your job because you have an aging population. How to complement this loss in human activities? What are we going to do in the service industry? What are we going to do in the high tech? What are we going to do in the secondary industry? This demand is redesigning of jobs and skills. Are we prepared to go to be retrained? Again, this is a wrong concept we have in our mind. If a person becomes an architect or a doctor or a lawyer, he got a degree behind his school, he stopped. This is completely against Sharia. Because أُطْلُبُ الْعِلْمِ فَرِيدَةُ مِنَ الْمَهْدِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Famous saying in Arabic, search of knowledge is you got to search your knowledge from your cradle up to the grave. Have we ever thought of, okay, next year what am I going to study? How am I going to enhance myself? Have we ever thought about it? How am I going to enhance myself? Not for the purpose of money, but me, as a mu'min, as a banda of Allah, how am I going to please by Allah by increasing my knowledge in a specific field? Do we plan ourselves? No, brother. 99.99% Muslims do not plan their academic life. And yet the very first ayat Allah revealed, Iqra, read. Very first ayat. First communication to Rasulullah SAW, Iqra, read. You are not interested. Mufti Shafisar Rahmatullah Alayhi, if this ayat has said something very, very ajeeb, where Allah SWT says, Allah is the one who taught man to the pen. Mufti Shafisar Rahmatullah Alayhi says under this, you can see Mufti Shafisar is crying when he's writing the tafsir. See, of course, the ulama are not using the pen. Addressing the ulama, khas. The ulama are not using the pen in today's time. Especially today where we've got an intellectual jihad going on. We are not using our pen. We don't know how to use our pen. We can't master English. We cannot master French. We can't master German. We can't master Arabic. I just went to an Arab country now. Of course, I'm telling you, brothers, even the Arabs can't speak Arabic. They can't speak Fusha Arabic. They speak Ami, which is not Arabic. The Arab that the Quran says, the Arab that Rasulullah SAW says to learn. The own Arab in Egypt, in Sudan, in all those places, they can't. It doesn't come on their tongue. Morana studied nine months there, he will tell you. Arabs don't speak Arabic. This is the highlight of this Ummah, brothers in Islam. These are, I know, harsh statements I'm making, but this is haq. Go to Saudi. You study in a Darul Uloom, you can't communicate on the street. Because the Arabic that you learn is the high Arabic, Fusha. The Arabic of the Quran, the Arabic of Rasulullah, Sahaba Kiram. They don't speak this Arabic. They speak this colloquial Arabic mixed with all type of things. In Morocco, it's the same thing. In Tunisia, it's the same thing. They have gone completely. We can't express ourselves. This is what Allah says. We have told you through the pen. You can't even express yourself through the pen. Allah says in the Quran, Ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahman. Allama al-Quran. Khalaq al-insan. Allamahu al-bayan. Allah has taught men how to speak. We can't even speak properly nowadays. We have lost all the qualities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us in ilm. We have lost all those qualities. This is what we are saying here. We're going to redesign all those jobs. And how we prepare ourselves to take the challenges of those jobs. Are we prepared? Say, for example, I'm an expert in tax. There's a new law to come. Today, if you look, all the professional bodies does it. There are doctors here, they will tell you. There are dentists here, they will tell you. There are accountants here, they will tell you. By law, you got to do your CPD, continuous professional training. You get marked for that. And if you do not do that, the government must take over the certificate from you, your license to operate. You've got to follow courses. You've got to enhance yourself. You must be up to date with your time. Imam Muhammad al-Shaybani, rahmullah, the student of Imam Abu Hanifa, rahmullah, every day used to go in the marketplace. And he used to inquire what is happening. The businessman said, hey, Imam Sahib, every day you come to do shopping? He said, no, I'm not coming here to do shopping. I'm coming to see what is in the marketplace. So that when you come to me, I know what you are talking and I can give you the right fatwa. Imam Muhammad al-Shaybani, the one who codified the Hanafi Fiqh, the one who established al-Mabsut, great scholar, every day was going in the souk. Yet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the worst place on earth, the best place of masjid, the worst place is the souk, is the marketplace. Yet he was going there, a great imam of his caliber, was going in the worst place on earth, just to equip himself about dunya with things. If for dunya with things he was doing, what about the real thing? What about Quran and Sunnah? How much sacrifice we must make? Just food for thought. Are we prepared to educate ourselves? If we are expert in computer science, what is the latest technology? Are we prepared to spend some money to come to that level? If we are not going to develop this Islamic attitude of equipping ourselves to be the required standard, then we're going to be suffered in this aging population process that's taking place in UK. You have to plan yourself. Next year, what I'm going to do? Okay, you haven't got money. Collect your money. After 2 years, I'm going to do this diploma, or I'm going to do this, I'm going to go to this country, I'm going to study. Plan yourself. It's not haram to acquire the dunya. Don't make haram what Allah and His Rasul never made haram. As long as the dunya is not in our heart. As long as the dunya is not in our heart, we can plan, no problem. The next impact of this population is the dependency ratio. How many people will be dependent in your own house? Today your father is working, and you too you are working. In 10 years time, your father, Allah give all of us hayati and good health, but we don't know. We can get diabetes, we can get a stroke, we can get any type of things that nowadays. How many dependency ratios? The dependency ratio is decreasing. That is, more people will have to contribute to sustain the old people. These are truths about the problem that you are facing, that the people went for a strike in London last week. We have to contextualize this. Now, what is the Islamic perspective of those things? Let us look at that. Very few points I'm going to raise. First point is, old age in Sharia is a great thing. To become old is a great thing in Sharia. A person whose beard is gray, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala feel ashamed to refuse his dua. Great thing to become old is Sharia. Hakim Akhtar Sahab, Dhamma Barakatuhum, I said in one of his budgets, something ajeeb he said. A wali of Allah, the older he grows, the stronger his memory becomes. Of course, again, science will tell you something else. But if you look at reality, you see it in the sohbat of the awliya, especially the Shaykhul Ahadith. Because the dua of Rasulullah s.a.w. may Allah keep you fresh and green for those who by heart my hadith and teach it to others. Especially those who teach Sahih al-Bukhari, you will find the khas ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the old age. Mufti Mahmud Saban, Jawzahi rahmatullahi alayhi, 90 years old, was quoting you Quran like nobody's business. Shana Kashmiri, Mufti Shafisa, all those people who taught, especially Bukhari Sharif, a special barakah in Sahih al-Bukhari. So old age is a great ni'mat. This is why now, when you get old, what are the fikr we are supposed to have? Let's go in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to face this problem of aging population, let's see, Allah has given us three examples in the Quran. Zakariya alayhi salatu wasalam to Maryam, when he saw his hair becoming gray, said, Ya Allah, I'm becoming gray, give me a waris to continue the da'wah. That's the first thing we have to keep in mind. Are we failing in our da'wah that today UK is being penalized, the EU is being penalized? In Lithuania, the schools are being closed because there are no students going in, especially in the farm areas. This is the scenario in EU. This is why there's a big debate. There are books already written on that. Should the European Union accept Turkey as a member? The Central Bank of, there was an article I read in the Times, the Central Bank of Europe is pushing for it. You will find that Tony Blair is pushing for it, and other countries, Italy is pushing for it, but then you get Austria and France are saying no for whatever reason, I don't want to go in politics. The point I'm raising is it's such a serious matter that they are prepared to compromise on culture and religion, because Turkey has 78 million people. If Turkey joins in the European Union, it will be 30% Muslim. Which means the entire world politics will change. It's not an easy decision to take, brothers. You understand what I'm trying to tell you. EU is having an aging population. They are arguing to promote, to include into the European Union a foreign culture, a foreign religion. This is how serious this matter is. I'm giving you reference. Go and check. As an elected difference here, go and check. This is how serious this matter is. This is why Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, again, he too, in his old age, even his wife, when the angels came to give news, she stopped hitting herself and getting excited. I'm going to get a baby at this age. This also is mentioned in the Quran. Why? To have children at this age, there is a purpose. When old age is coming, the maqsad of a Muslim is to make dawah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He acts upon it and makes others act upon it, so that when there is action upon the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is harmony in society. And all those problems you are having, there is no harmony, the society is dysfunctioning, is mainly because the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not being acted upon. So simple, it's a straightforward equation. إِنَّا أَطَيْنَكَ الْكَوْثَرِ also reflect the same. The Arabs used to say that the tail of Rasulullah SAW have been cut. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed إِنَّا أَطَيْنَكَ الْكَوْثَرِ to challenge them. Their tail have been cut. Why? Because Rasulullah SAW, they were criticizing him. You do not have a son. Therefore, your nabuwat will stop. Rasulullah SAW had the same fikr. How this nabuwat, this risala, how the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can be expanded. The first thing you get in the Ayat al-Quran, I'm proving it to you from the Quran. The age, when we become old, we're supposed to think about dawah. Because dawah is a tool to remove all those problems. Because Allah says in the Quran, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدٍ. Verily, I've created man in turmoil. Then Allah continues to explain how to remove all those turmoil. One of it is dawah. This is a solution. Very important. Dawah can be something Jamaat is doing a wonderful job. It can be the Khanka who is doing a wonderful job. It can be our own behavior at work, it can be a wonderful action. First solution. The second one is you got to reconsider, brothers. I know the average person is getting £800 a month. I know that. But we have in the light of what is happening in UK and the EU for the next 40 years, we got to reconsider the role of women at work. Do they really have to go and work? I'm not saying to take your wife out of work, brothers. Everybody knows their financial problems. But we have to reconsider for the purpose of the next generation. Is it really necessary for women to work? Or her place is at home to increase the ummah of Rasulullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created her for this purpose. The third solution is, in Sharia, you see all those problems got to do with what we call in economics, the voluntary sector. Basically, we are in this world to satisfy our needs. I mean, as human beings. As Muslims, we are making the ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the general public, he say, I'm in this world to enjoy life, make maja. So to make maja, to satisfy my needs, there are two ways. Some of the goods are given by the government, what you call public goods, like your security, your gardens, blah, 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 your airports, etc. Because individuals cannot give the services in both billions of pounds. The second one is your market mechanism. You want to buy the lower supply, demand determines the price, determines how much you want to consume. The third one is your voluntary sector. We as Muslims, we got to contribute our these things. This is why you got sadaqatul fitr, you got zakat, you got baytul mal, you got your awqaf. Why Islam has given all those things is if you read the life of Rasulullah, especially in Madinatul Munawwara, the way Rasulullah was running his government was to encourage the citizens to contribute to alleviate those poverty. For example, in the Badr, the Prophet said, whoever buys this well would be a Jannati. Hazrat Uthman stood up. He said, I'm going to buy this well. Whoever gives this, we need this for the peace of Allah. The battle of Tabuk, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, 100% whatever he had, peace of Allah. Do you find that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was encouraging the Sahaba to develop a voluntary sector in the economy? This is what Bill Clinton started about 15 years ago. And this is what the New Labour Party is talking now, voluntary sector. What responsibility we have as a citizen to alleviate the financial burden of others. Because the state got its limits. Tax got its limits. How many tax you want to put? How many pounds sterling you want to print? You're going to create hyperinflation in the economy. This is why we have to contribute. Very important we as Muslims to contribute to alleviate others. The third one is we've got to redesign our financial setup. That's a deep subject which I won't be able to touch now. The fifth one, I think, is we got to increase the population. Now, this increase of population, if you go on the website, there have been a lot of criticism on that. Muslims want to increase the population to produce terrorism. Come on. That's nonsense. The Catholic, Roman Catholics are in this country for how many centuries, brothers? And abortion is haram for them in their religion. Right? They are not supposed to do contraception. They wanted to set up a papal state here. Up to now, they haven't been able to do anything. This is a wrong, it is a wrong way of thinking. What is this nonsense? They say, we got to have a world, we got to sustain the economy. We contribute positively to this. And now our Muslims are saying, no, polygamy is haram. How can polygamy be haram when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given permission? If you look at all the Arab countries, besides few like Saudi Arabia and I think Kuwait, all the Arab countries have come with legislation and the pressure from the colonial powers to limit polygamy. The same very people who organized the Cairo conference, the same people who organized the Beijing conference to limit population growth in Africa, today they want to increase the population in Europe. What a hypocrisy. What a hypocrisy we live in. Understand the world politics, where we're going, and where we situate ourselves in that brothers and sisters. You know what I'm talking here. I'm sure you understand what I'm talking here. They had a Cairo conference where they tell you, you got to be condoned at school. You got to allow free sex at school. But the children must be educated. They must not have a lot of children. We do not have enough food. Brothers in Islam, if you make research, the depth of food Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept in the ocean is beyond our imagination. It's beyond our imagination. With genetic modification, now how much food can be? The whole entire Egyptian economy is being run on modified food. The entire Israeli agriculture sector is being done on modified products. Genetically, they are modified to increase the production. In Japan, they have modified the eggs of fish. They're increasing 6 times more fish. What is this nonsense? We do not have any food. Allah is a Razzaq. We as Muslims, we must not have this fear that we are not going to have food if you have more than 2 children. Birth control is against the ayahs of the Quran which I'm going to come to you. The average British person is having 1 child per person. But if you look at the Quran al-Kareem, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu taqullah. Ya ayyuhal nas, ittaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafs. All you people, fear Allah who created you from one person. وخلق منها زوجها and from her هو عليه الصلاة والسلام was created from his rib. وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا. Allah has enhanced humanity. We're talking of a geometric progression. Those who do mathematics will understand what I'm talking here. This ayat is talking about geometric progression, not of arithmetic progression. The ideal in a marriage is not 1 and 2, it's more than 2 children. This is what this ayat. You understand, Mawlana, Arabic? If you understand the mathematics of this ayat, the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you the spirit of children is not 2. The average British is having 1.74. This is the statistics in UK. And we too get caught in that. No, our woman must work. Must not have children. And then you end up with an aging population. When we are all nobody to look for us. We have been trying to work the whole our life And at the end of the line, there's nobody to cater for us. For what have we been working? Why we spoil our life? Have a lot of children and enjoy children, brothers. ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام and see Allah from whom you're going to ask to write and the link of the Arham, the womb. You're going to be asked about that. If you want to have children, have children with your own wife. The door of polygamy is open. But of course, with Abu, there are conditions for polygamy. This is not my topic here. Have proper children. Do not have illegitimate children, brothers. If you look at the average population, I've just statistics now, of paternity tests, out of every 10 couples, one man is having doubt on his wife in UK. Go on Google, type paternity test. You get the shock of your life, what is happening in UK. So much of illegitimate children are happening in this country. According to certain statistics, 17%. 17% of the population, brothers. These are not single figures I'm putting in front of you where we deviate from the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is where we end up. We have illegitimate children who doesn't want to care for us because he doesn't know whether this is my father. You better go in an old age home. But as the Quran says, what the Quran says, what is the structure we must give? Allah says in the Quran, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّهُ إِلَّا إِيَّهُ Allah has made the faisla that you must not worship anybody but He. After Tawheed, Allah brings in. After His Tawheed, Allah brings in responsibility towards parents. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا And show mercy towards your parents. إِمَّا لَبْيُغَنَّ عِنْدَ الْكَتِبَةِ If one of them, if by you, attain old age, أو كِلَاهُمَا or both of them, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفْ Do not utter a word of contempt to them. The word "uf" here is majali, that is, don't raise your voice. With love and affection, it comes in the hadith. Each time you look at your parents with the gaze of rahmah, Allah will give you one hajj sawab, brother. Once you give this gaze of rahmah and a smile, what are you going to get by Allah? Just think about it. But the structure of society is dump them in the old age, dump them in the old age, and let the state look after them. This is completely un-Islamic, brother. Completely. There's no place in Islam for this type of mentality. For this type of reasoning when we face an aging population. We have a responsibility towards our parents, our dada, our nana, our nani, our mother, our kala, whoever is old in our family. That falls in special bab and sikh, babud nafaka. Fuqaha have written volumes on that. Who has a responsibility to maintain who? Deep subjects, deep discussion in sikh on that, babud nafaka. So we can't run away from that. This is ayat of Quran on that. The hadith of Rasulullah, the fuqaha have written on that. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying here. That we have, when we talk about reorganizing our family, we're talking about polygamy and all those things, we have to look at a bigger picture. And I think this is where we are failing. We got a one small masla in the masjid, we're going to talk about it for 6 months. And that masla also is maybe one ikhtilaf between one imam and the other imam. Where are we going? There are better, more important, urgent issues to be addressed in UK, brothers. Wallahi, there are much more urgent issues that we have to address in UK. This is one of them I'm addressing. The last one, okay, there are so many. We've got to reorganize our family structure together, and this will be very, very important. I told you to have children. The question that you'll ask me, Mona and I got only 800 pounds. I got another children. What am I supposed to do? Brothers in Islam, I told you the beginning of my talk. One is Aqal and one is Iman. Aqal cannot overrule Iman. The Iman will tell you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala look after you when you were in the womb of your mother. The same Allah has looked upon you now you are 30, 40, 50 years old. The same Allah will look after you. Leave it in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, if I tell you the average alim, how much he gets in this country, you get the shock of your life. It's beyond your imagination. Yes, the ulama have more than 5 children, and alhamdulillah, they're going for hajj, they're going for umrah, Allah put barakat in this money. These are living examples. Mawlana Shafi'i Thani rahmatullah alayhi has said something very important. Brothers, if you are late, you can go. I still have to take about 5-10 more minutes. Just like to have a Khalifa, the entire population must contribute to pay him. Just like to have a judge, we got to pay tax to sustain him. In the same way, it's such important matter like imamat, such important matter like giving fatawa, which demands 24 hours sacrifice, the ummah must contribute to sustain him. We are completely off track. Completely off track on this issue of looking after our ulama. I know, I'm giving you a blow. Make me mouth. This needs to be said. When we die, we want this maulvi to perform our salatul janazah. When we're given children, we want this maulvi to give azan to the children. Blah, blah. We want nikah also, we want this maulvi to perform our nikah. These are not ordinary things. You're coming in this world, you need a maulvi to give azan. You want getting married, you want a maulvi to perform your nikah, half of your iman will be fulfilled. You die, you want a maulvi to perform your salatul janazah. These are not ordinary things that we are talking here. And we don't want to contribute. And then what happened? The poor maulvi, he got to make a sideline business. When he make a sideline business, look at this maulvi. He's not sincere. We are not sincere, brothers, not the maulvi sub. We are not sincere. That was our duty, that was our community. I'm sorry to raise those issues. I don't need your money. Alhamdulillah, I'm a professional. Bismillah ta'ala. But generally, if you go to Pakistan, you go to India, and many other places you go, this is how we treat our ulama. This is wrong. This is wrong. Completely wrong. Mawshaf Rikhani, rahmatullah alayhi, says, because it's a hadith of Qudsi where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, should, it's a hadith of Qudsi, Allah himself saying that through the mouth of Rasulullah sallam, should there be permissibility to show haughtiness? Show up. Allah says, haughtiness is for me. Whoever shows off, he's cursed. The hadith of Qudsi. Mawshaf Rikhani, rahmatullah alayhi, says, should it be permissible to show haughtiness? The ulama should have shown haughtiness because they got one of the most beautiful qualities of Allah in them, the quality of ilm. It is mentioned in the hadith, when the day of Qiyamah in Maidan al-Hashr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, who are those people who have got ilm in them? The ulama will be gathered. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, I make fast of Jannah for you today to enter Jannah, and I don't care who says what. Because of the quality of ilm in that person. The Quran Sharif in the heart of that person, you just learn to the qadar of that. You learn to learn the qadar of that ilm, brothers in Islam. Ma, this is not my topic. The last issue, two more issues I want to say. This addresses our doctors and people in the medical field. When you have an aging population, the three main diseases that we see, according to statistics, are cancer in UK. Out of every three people, one is ending up with cancer. Diabetes, I think out of every five, one is getting diabetes. And heart disease, which is the top of the hit balance. Right? What can we do to attend to those things? One thing I'm going to give you a secret, which I learned from the elders from Nizamuddin. You see, a pond. You can throw a rock in it, a stone. The stone is dropped in one place. But the ripples will go very, very, very far. If you have figures now, even though you do not succeed, you will get power for that, the cost on the figure. How can we assist the state in alleviating the problem of the old people regarding heart disease, regarding cancer, regarding diabetes? And other disease, of course. Very important, we as Muslims, especially those who got the means, financial means, and those who are doctors and involved in that field, to consider that. And finally, brothers in Islam, regarding the aging population, is how can we redistribute? We got to think how to redistribute the Muslim population in UK. Very, very important. It's not possible that half of the Muslim population are staying in London. In the long run, it's going to have bad effects on the ummah. This is not something to discuss in Parliament. We're discussing a policy here, governmental policy, community policy. It's not something we're going to discuss. That takes hours and hours, redistribution of an ethnic group. So, brothers in Islam, in a nutshell, we are facing the problem of aging population in UK. I've given you enough statistics. I don't want to waste your time with all those heavy, heavy documents from FSA and so on. Believe me, I woke up 3 o'clock in the morning to prepare yesterday. Because one brother, I gave this bayan for one brother. he sent me an email. He said that he heard I came. He sent me an email. Monana, where are you making your bayan? This had a tremendous effect on my heart. I said, I cannot leave Leicester without addressing a few words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, all praise for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has selected me to come and talk here. All praise for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Basically, what we're looking at here is turned up on the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where Rasulullah says, تَزَوَّدُ الْوَدُودُ الْوَلُودُ فَإِنِّي مُكَاثِرٌ بِكُمْ الْأُمَمْ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. You people have a lot of children. Choose your wife who is loving, caring for you, and who will bear a lot of children, so that on the day of Qiyamah, I am proud of my ummah. This is satisfying. Having children is not only helping the nation, it is not only satisfying your own biological need and psychological need, but satisfying Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day of Qiyamah. And also is a solution to the problem we're facing. The statisticians and actuarial scientists say if we can keep the progress as is now, about 2 children per family, we can sustain the economy. But it's not going to happen. Today itself I talked to experts, they say you cannot revert the situation, especially in Italy, it's very, very bad. The second one, Rasulullah says, مَنْ لَمْ يَرْهَمْ صَغِيرَنَا وَلَمْ يُؤَكِّرْ كَبِيرَنَا فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. Whoever does not have mercy towards our small ones and do not respect our elderly ones, فَلَيْسَ مِنَّا. He is not among us. This is how much respect we must have for aging. Let us say it about Muslims here, elderly people in general. So this aging population, brother, that you have been addressing is not an ordinary issue. We have to pay attention to that. This is among many other problems. As Muslims, we must be in a position to think, put our mind together. I have told those ideas to you because I'm not here, I'm traveling next week. But you people have to start working. This has always been my talk here. I come and throw ideas to you. One of you will take it off, and inshallah, I'll get sawab on the day of Qiyamah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give all of us the tawfiq to act upon what has been said. If there has been any mistake, it is from me. If there's any good has been said, it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't know. You want to ask question or it's too late? It's too late. You're tired, nah? Okay, those who want to ask question, ask later. يا ولي الأولين ويا خير الآخرين ويا ذو القوة المتين ويا أرحم الراحمين يا ولي السماوات والأرض يا حي يا قيوم يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد بعدد كل معلوم لك. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. اللهم اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذريتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وقنا عذاب القبر وقنا عذاب الحشر وقنا عذاب الفقر وقنا عذاب الدين واحشرنا يوم القيامة مع المتقين ومع الأبرار يا عزيز يا غفار. ربنا زدنا علما نافعا ورزقا واسعا وحلالا وطيبا وعملا صالحا ومتقبلا وشفاء من كل داء وقلبا منورا ولسانا ذاكرا وإيمانا كاملا ويقينا صادقا وخلقا حميدا يا رب. اللهم إنا نسألك من شر ما سألك منه نبيك وحبيبك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذ منه نبيك وحبيبك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. أنت المستعان ولك البلاغ ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. سبحان الله يا رب.